It can be difficult at first to understand the quantum Fourier transform as well as its circuit decomposition. And here we're going to take a look at a geometric picture for deriving the coefficients of the quantum Fourier transform and a little example on two qubits. So let's begin with this mathematical formula, which tells us what the quantum Fourier transform on k qubits is doing. It's taking a state that represents an integer, z. So for instance, on three qubits, the state 7 would be 111. The state 2 would be 0, 1, 0, etc. And we map the integer z to a superposition that's uniform in magnitude, but varies in phase. And here's the formula for evaluating that phase. And we have a superposition over all of the computational basis states b, the states from 0, 0, 0 up to 1, 1, 1 in the regular old z eigenbasis. This can be a little opaque and hard to understand, but it gets easier if we look at an example on two qubits. Here we have the matrix for the quantum Fourier transform on two qubits. It's just a half, which is 1 over 2 to the k with, you know, k equals 2, square rooted, cancels out the 2, you just get 2. And we have the columns 1, 1, 1, 1, which is what happens if I multiply every integer b by 0 and then take e to the 2 pi I times 0. And then to understand the rest of the coefficients, we can understand z, the input, as a speed with which the quantum Fourier transform proceeds around the unit circle. So if we have 0, 1, the 1 state, the quantum Fourier transform will take one step at a time on this diagram. So it'll go to 1i minus 1 minus i, as we see here, 1i minus 1 minus i. If we take two steps at a time for the input state 2, right, or 1, 0 on two qubits, we end up with 1 minus 1, 1 minus 1, exactly as we see on the 2 state here. If we take three steps at a time on a circle with four points on it, that's actually the same as taking one step backwards, and we can see that we have 1 minus I minus 1 I in the coefficients in the final column of the matrix. Now, we went over a little bit how to decompose this into a circuit, but I figured I'd do it concretely here for you. We have a Hadamard gate, a controlled square root of z, another Hadamard gate on the target qubit of the control square root of z, and then a swap gate at the end. Now, this swap gate at the end wouldn't always appear in different figures that you might see in research papers or textbooks or courses, for example, because it's often assumed that you can do swap gates like this one classically, just by relabeling which qubits are which at the end. But for the sake of completeness, I include it here. Now, we can calculate the result of performing these four gates in order simply by putting the matrices in the reverse of the order that they appear in the circuit. So we have swap, identity tensor Hadamard, the controlled square root of z, and Hadamard tensor identity here. And I invite you to multiply these four matrices by yourself and observe that they do indeed recreate the quantum Fourier transform on two qubits. Now, if that's too easy, let's do another challenge, or let's have you do another challenge, in which you decompose into a circuit the quantum Fourier transform on one qubit. Now, on one qubit, you have 1 over root 2, because k is just 1. And then you can either proceed around the unit circle 0 steps at a time, staying at 1, or 1 step at a time, but missing this I. So you would just go from 1 to minus 1. And if you can find a circuit decomposition for that, we may have already discussed it in the course, then you're well on your way to understanding the quantum Fourier transform.